Καλησπέρα. Έχουμε δει μια πάρα πολύ δυνατή ταινία, ένα πολύ δυνατό ντοκιμαντέρ, μια φοβερή ιστορία όπως τη χαρακτήρισε και ο αδερφός του Ιντρίσα. Έχουμε τη χαρά να έχουμε μαζί μας έναν από τους συνσκηνοθέτες, από τους ανθρώπους που μετέχουν στην συλλογικότητα, στην κολεκτίβα που έχει την ευθύνη της παραγωγής και της σκηνοθεσίας της ταινίας αυτής. Είναι μαζί μας ο Χαβιέρ Αρτίγας, ελπίζω να το προφέρω σωστά κάπως, που έχει μια συμμετοχή από ό,τι είδαμε συνολική σε όλα τα στάδια της παραγωγής της ταινίας. Αυτό το οποίο είναι προφανές ότι μας μεταδίδει μια τέτοια ιστορία είναι ότι υπάρχουν διαφορετικά στάδια στα οποία οι ευρωπαϊκές πολιτείες, τα ευρωπαϊκά κράτη δείχνουν αυτό το οποίο μπορούμε να συμπυκνώσουμε ως θεσμικό ρατσισμό απέναντι στους μετανάστες και τους πρόσφυγες που προσπαθούν να περάσουν τα σύνορα. Και αυτό αποτυπώνεται σε διάφορα στάδια εδώ της ιστορίας, με πιο χαρακτηριστικά, αφενός μεν την υποτίμηση των προβλημάτων υγείας που μπορούν να υπάρχουν και οδηγούν στο θάνατο υπό συνθήκες κράτησης, και στη συνέχεια στην απόλυτη ουσιαστικά διαφορία απέναντι στην ανάγκη της οικογένειας και στο δικαίωμα των δικών του να έχουν μια εξήγηση, μια πραγματική ερμηνεία για τις συνθήκες θανάτου του ανθρώπου τους που πέθανε σε ένα ξένο έδαφος, και μια διαφορία επίσης στο να ταυτοποιηθεί ισορρός και να επιστραφεί στους οικείους του. Επίσης φαίνεται και μια διαφορία και του δικαστικού συστήματος να διερευνήσει ουσιαστικά τις συνθήκες θανάτου του ανθρώπου. Αυτά μας είναι πολύ οικεία, δυστυχώς. Δηλαδή ήταν στιγμές που νιώθαμε ότι βλέπαμε σκηνές από τη δική μας κοινωνία και ανακαλούμε και υποθέσεις τις οποίες μπορούμε να σκεφτούμε ότι μας έχουν απασχολήσει την τελευταία δεκαετία, 15 ετία τουλάχιστον. Θα δώσω όμως το λόγο στον Χαβιέρ για να κυρίως να μας πει ποιες ήταν οι δυσκολίες τις οποίες αντιμετωπίσαν στη διάρκεια αυτής της έρευνας και αν θέλει να μας πει το πώς ακριβώς βιώσαν οι ίδιοι την περιπέτεια αυτή, δηλαδή την αναζήτηση ουσιαστικά της σωρού του Ιντρίσα και το πώς άλλαξε τους ίδιους ουσιαστικά η διαδικασία παραγωγής αυτής της ταινίας.
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this festival. It's beautiful to be here, and thanks for watching the film and staying. And about the difficulties that we had to investigate this case, well, I would say all of them. Like, there was no way to find out what happened with Idrissa, and it's probably the most frustrating thing in this project. We started thinking that we would be able to explain in this film what really happened, that it would be an uncover from the official version of the police, which is that Idrissa just died of natural causes. He had a heart attack, a 21-year-old guy who was healthy, who had crossed Africa by himself, suddenly had a heart attack. So there are many things that can lead to a heart attack, we know that. But there was no way to find out. So at some point in this five-year process that we had been engaged in the investigation and also the filming of this project, we decided to shift it to something completely different. So we stopped asking ourselves what happened, because there was no way to entering in what happened in this detention center, and we decided to try to perform a reparation. Although we know that reparation when someone dies is not possible, but at least we felt like we had to inform the family and finally repatriate the body, which is something that the Spanish state would was supposed to do. It was, I mean, if it was an American or someone from another European country, the Spanish state would have informed the family immediately and would have paid for the repatriation. But given that it was a black person from Africa, so they didn't care. So we decided to do this in a community way with a crowdfunding campaign. We got the money to bring the body back. And we decided that this project, instead of informing what really happened with Idrissa, could be an opportunity to let all European spectators to participate in his burial ceremony. So in this sense, I think it's a kind of reparation, because, and this is the reason why this last scene is so long, because everything is an excuse to bring you there, to make you European people, us European people, realize what it means to be in this ceremony and to feel how it is for their community and their village and their family to have their boy back in their hometown and perform this. But this was completely unexpected. We really started the project wanting to uncover what happened. But there is a, probably like everywhere in Europe, there's a total opacity. There's no way to find out what happens in detention centers, at least in Spain. We know that they have surveillance cameras, but that day they didn't work. That's what they said. And there is no explanation, there is no official information, and there is no way we can get it. Still, the case of Idrissa, it's important, although we didn't manage to find out what really happened, because it was it was a case that led a lot of people in Spain organize themselves to start a strong campaign against detention centers. And it is after the case of Idrissa in 2012 that the network CIESNO, which means no detention centers, started. And it's a very strong campaign that has let most of Spanish people know that detention centers exist. So the problem was that before 2012, like, nobody knew that these places existed and that people were put there as if they were put in jail, although they hadn't committed any crime or anything. It's just like an irregular situation, but it's not a crime to not to have papers. So I think this is the only positive thing that came out of Idrissa's death. And the rest, as I said at the beginning, is just frustration, because I think there's a big difference with the Yuri Jallo case. They managed to get a lot of information. I don't know if it was a question of money or energy, but we couldn't really get to the end of the question about what happened with Idrissa Diallo. The case was dismissed, which means that the judge thinks it's not worth investigating it, because they said, well, it's a natural death, so just let's leave it like that. So there's two ways of avoiding such a case for a judge. One of them is to close it and say, well, I think there was nothing wrong, which allows you to go to the next step, which is what happened with the Yuri Jallo case, that they kept going to more and more steps. In the case, but the other way to avoid it is to dismiss it, which means it's not the case, it's not closed, it's just like frozen until we find more evidence. So it's there in the same court, and you cannot go further. And if the judge decides that it's not worth investigating it, although you can bring more proof, if the judge considers that it's not evidence, it just stays there frozen. So that's where we are. In the first step, the case is frozen, and there's no way we can go farther. So.
Να κάνω μία ερώτηση στο Ξαβιέ και αμέσως μετά θα περάσουμε στην συζήτηση για την υπόθεση του Γιούρι Τζάλος, που επίσης είναι εμβληματική, σημαντική στη Γερμανία. Η ερώτηση είναι, περιέγραψε ποια είναι η δικαστική διαδικασία, και από ό,τι καταλαβαίνω είναι μια εκκρεμής διαδικασία, δηλαδή δεν έχει κλείσει ουσιαστικά τυπικά. Πέρα από το δικαστική οδό, που έχει τα προβλήματα τα οποία βλέπουμε ότι είναι κοινά στην πραγματικότητα. Δηλαδή υπάρχει ο θεσμικός ρατσισμός αγγίζει και τη δικαιοσύνη. Υπάρχει ένα είδος ανεξάρτητου μηχανισμού έρευνας σε σχέση με τα φαινόμενα αστυνομικής αυθαιρεσίας ή σε σχέση με τις συνθήκες διαβίωσης των μεταναστών στα κέντρα κράτησης. Υπάρχει μια τέτοιου τύπου θεσπισμένη διαδικασία στην Ισπανία ή στην Καταλωνία, ας πούμε, σε επίπεδο ομόσπονδου κράτους.
Yes, there are like we have a juridical figure in Spain which is very old, which I think it exists in other countries too, which is the popular accusation, which means that organized people, associations, any collective can be part of a trial, although they are not directly affected by it. So it's basically the same that an ombudsman would do, but it has the advantage that it's by organized people. It's funny that this sounds very nice. It's funny that in Spain most of the people that use this system are far right people. So it's important to note that organized Nazis in Spain are always using this figure to get into trials in order to put their agenda. And there's even a political party that just came out of organized people that were performing this strategic litigation. That's how we call it. It's a strategic litigation through popular accusation. But this is the means we have, and it was what we did in the Idrissa Diallo case, to denounce officially, like not parallelly, like not, but officially, and to try to find out what happened.
Προφανώς μπορούμε να συνεχίσουμε τη συζήτηση μετά. Θα έλεγα όμως να δώσουμε το λόγο και στους άλλους δύο καλεσμένους μας που εκπροσωπούν και αυτή μια συλλογικότητα, την πρωτοβουλία Γιούρι Τζάλοχ. Είναι μια περίπτωση θανάτου μετανάστη σε συνθήκες κράτησης στη Γερμανία. Υπάρχει προφανώς δικαστική διαδικασία που είναι σε εξέλιξη και από ό,τι αντιλαμβάνομαι υπάρχουν και πολύ πρόσφατες εξελίξεις σε σχέση με αυτό. Θα δώσω λοιπόν διαδοχικά το λόγο, αρχικά να μας παρουσιάσουν την υπόθεση και τις εξελίξεις της και γιατί αυτή η υπόθεση έχει αποκτήσει μια μεγάλη σημασία, τουλάχιστον στο γερμανικό πλαίσιο, στην Αντίν Σαΐντ πρώτα και στη συνέχεια στον Τόμας Μακμούτζα Ντιντά για να μας παρουσιάσουν ακριβώς την υπόθεση.
Thank you. Uri Jalloh was killed on the 7th of January 2005 in a detention cell in Dessau, which is a town like 120 kilometers down of in the south of Berlin. It's like a 15 years struggling to clarify the case, so we just try to give you a short image of what happened and what we are doing. So I will explain what happened on the 7th of January and how they killed him. He came from a club in the morning. It was like 8 o'clock in the morning. He met some women on street and he asked them to phone somebody, or he wanted to call a friend to sleep there, but he has no charger in his phone, so he asked this German woman to give him a handy or a cell phone, but they refused to do that, so they played a little bit, like they were laughing and running from him, and then they called the police to tell them that there is a foreigner who harassed them. So the police came and they forced him to show his identity, and he said he refused. Oh, this is what the police say now. He refused and he said, no, you always want to see my identity, you know me, blah blah blah. But they got aggressive, the police got aggressive, and they took him with violence in the car. They bring him to the police station, and then it was like 8:30. They called a doctor, and the guy who called the doctor, he was an officer in charge. He told the doctor, come, then you just take the blood from a black African And then this doctor said, oh, I don't find any vein by these black people. And they were both laughing. They say, okay, then you bring a special injection thing to get the blood of him. So it was, we have proved like a racist telephone call from this officer who was in charge and the doctor. The doctor came, he took the blood also by force. Then they bring him in a detention cell, and in the cell there was nothing, just a podest where they put him on, and they shackled him on hands and feet. That means he couldn't move at all. Actually, he could move like 10 centimeters up and down, just his head, not his body. Now it was like 9:15, and there were like 3-4 controllings by some different police officers. And at 12:05, the fire alarm starts to switched on, and the officer in charge he just put it off. Until a woman in the office said, oh, please go down and check what's going on there. So he went down. Then 12:11, they called the fire brigade, like 6 minutes after the fire alarm went on. And when the fire brigade came, they didn't. They went into the cell, or in this detention cell floor, and they couldn't find the person. Because they just were thinking there's a person missed in the detention cell floor, but they couldn't find this person. So when they came out, then the police officers told them he's shackled. So then they got the key, and then this fire brigade guy, he recognized, okay, I saw fires, it's a person who's burning, it's nothing else, it's just a person who's burning there. And then it was like 12:35, and he reached the cell and he just put water on his body, but his body was completely burned. So the original photographs from the crime scene shows a completely burned body, which is actually very very unbelievable to see that. You cannot see the picture here, but if you search on internet, you will get an image of how it looked like there. But from this time, they started to hide what really happened there. They called two different police groups to investigate in the case, and one just was responsible for saving the crime scene. But we say, or we know now, they just clear the crime scene. They eliminated a lot of evidences, and they said from the beginning that he burned himself. Yeah, there was no accelerants, there was no lighter, there was no nothing, but they just say into the video documentation that he burned himself. And this is a story that they tell us until today, or they try to make people believe that this is the truth. But in reality, we know, and we bring a lot of facts, that this is not the truth. They actually beat him up and then they burned him with accelerants, because there's no other way to do that. Immediately after this happened, the friends of Uri, who was living in Dessau, they became to know it, and they went to the. They became to know that a friend of them was dead in the police station. So they went there. They pushed the people away and they say, "Go away! You don't have to do anything here." But the people from this moment, they really start to fight. The initiative was founded very soon after they killed him, after they killed Uri. And they informed the friend of Uri is Mokhtar Bar. He has a call center in Dessau. He contacted the family of Uri in Guinea. He's also from Guinea, he grew up there. And then they start to engage lawyers, and they got a lot of support from self-organized refugees organization, which give them power to put energy and clarify by themselves. Because a lot of people say you cannot say it's murder, but actually it was very obvious that it was murder from the beginning. So since that, the initiative is fighting for clarifying the case. We research by ourselves, and we are completely self-organized to show the civil society what really happened there and how police is is hiding the truth from this and what kind of crime they do and trying to lie to the people and trying to hide it.
Ευχαριστούμε και εγώ θα δώσω το λόγο στον Τόμας αφού θέσω και το ερώτημα το οποίο θα ήθελα να παρουσιαστεί. Το έχουν περάσει 14 χρόνια από τότε. Προφανώς υπάρχει ένα στάδιο δικαστικής ουσιαστικά διερεύνησης υπόθεσης. Θα ήθελα, νομίζω όλοι μας θα θέλαμε, να μάθουμε το πώς ακριβώς αντιμετώπισε η γερμανική δικαιοσύνη το περιστατικό αυτό. Εάν δηλαδή έγινε έρευνα, εάν η έρευνα αυτή απέδωσε έστω κατηγορίες σε ένα πρώτο στάδιο, αν μπήκε στο αρχείο και ποιος ήταν ο ρόλος των οργανώσεων που οργάνωσαν ουσιαστικά την προσπάθησαν να διερευνήσουν την υπόθεση στην εξακρίβωση της αλήθειας και σε ποιο στάδιο βρισκόμαστε τώρα.
Hello. First of all, I want to make a little comment to the movie. I was very touched for the Idrissa. He was from Guinea, like Uri Jalo. The different spelling of his name, Diallo, is the French colonial spelling. This is the English spelling, and the German court has a W at the end. So it depends on your colonial master how your name is spelled, just for you to know. And the second thing about the movie is that we learn a lot about the African family and tradition, but we do not learn about the accountability, responsibility of the Spanish state. So this is very striking to me and as a parallel to our case. So the procedures, the juridical procedures, are not really somewhere you could say they shed light on the case. The procedures were organized cover-up. It started with the investigation team of the police coming. The videographer enters the scene from the backyard into the cellar. And before he comes into the cell, when nothing has been done to investigate, he says twice, "I'm going now into the cell where the African man burnt himself." After 4 minutes, the video stops. No investigation is on the video recorded. Photos, very rarely photos about the scene. Then they make autopsy. With the autopsy, the same. Very rare photos. They say he died on an inhalative heat shock, means he has breathed in hot air and then reflectively died. There are no pictures of the airways. There's a picture of the esophagus written, "This is the airway with sooth in it." So it's wrongly written. We only get to know that after, years after. So the prosecution then made investigation with wrong data. So the mattress Uri Jalo was fixed on was oversized. They used normal mattresses to show how much a person can move to bend over the fire. With an oversized mattress, you can't even. But at the end of the day, they constructed a story that Uri Jalo was having a lighter. No explanation where the lighter is coming from, by a matter of fact. Then he started the fire on the right-hand side. And when it was big enough, with his hand right in the fire, he bent over to inhale the heat, the hot air. And then he reflectively died, but he didn't fall down there. He goes back to the far left of the mattress and put the lighter under his left side of the trunk. So they didn't find the lighter in the investigation in the first place. 3 days later, the lighter appears. The lighter was never investigated for 7 years. Then they found out no traces of this cell, not of Uri Jalo, not of the mattress, not of the clothing. no DNA. What they found was stuff out of their cell. Different fibers, burnt and melted in, not burnt, melted in, and totally unaddressed from heat, just sticking to it on top. And a white man's DNA. This is what they found. The explanation, the federal investigation, while investigating the lighter, put all these traces onto that lighter. This is the explanation of the prosecution. You know, so this is how they behaved. The first assumption, he lit the fire himself, so no policemen involved. All of them are victims. The only charge they put out was negligence for not finding a lighter and coming down too late, switching off the fire alarm. So, and this is how the procedures were derailed from murder, from finding out how the fire actually broke out and how you can have a fire in a tiled cell with a fireproof mattress only, and then afterwards the whole mattress is burned down to flakes and the person looks like out of the crematorium. This is what they never answered, for it was not part of the charge of negligence. So when they investigated, they said to the fire investigator, you start fire burning. Make this mattress burning. We don't want to know how. After 6 minutes, you stop. So to make it short, first trial, all police officers were set free from the charges. So one was with the lighter. This one can no more be charged for anything. The second one is the officer in charge who went down late. This was repeated after we made a pledge against it, or the family made a pledge against it. So it restarted in 2011, the second time. Then he was charged with €10,800 for not, you know, being not careful enough, coming down too late, not looking properly after him. So we have a situation that a person shackled and burned in the police cell has a price. This price is €10,800. We again made a pledge against it. Then they were saying, no, everything is fine. The matter of the lighter, who has no traces, was not even raised in the High Court decision. In the meantime, the prosecution, with all these facts, had to start an investigation into unknown reasons of that. And this has now been finished through the Upper Court of Saxony-Anhalt lately by stating it cannot be found out who of the police officers did what. And if we cannot see who did what, we cannot charge them. So, on the other side, all what is known in the case has been provided through the activities and investigation of our initiative. On the civil ground, also with the crowdfunding, so we had several expertises, fire expertise, saying the mattress doesn't burn. We had general expertise with a fire investigator who looked into the files, whether it was investigated properly. Answer, no. There was a toxicological expert who said no carbon monoxide in the lungs and the blood, no stress hormone changes, so he cannot have been alive lighting the fire in the cell. And the third one was the medical report saying the files are not really properly there. We said already the photos of the airways are not there. And X-ray in the first place was refused. So they said also the medical investigation afterwards was not done in a proper way. The latest expertise we had now related to a very early investigation after the X-ray was refused through the autopsy in the first place. We actually took the corpse without telling them. They said they wanted to send it back to Guinea. So they were very fast and very keen that the corpse is sent back to Guinea. So we took it and put it to Frankfurt for a second autopsy. But the man there is also part of the system somehow. So he made a section first and X-ray later after his section. So then there was no pictures from it, just some four prints of the broken nose bone. And he said he could not really find out whether this broken nose was when he was alive or after that. Maybe through the transport it could have been broken later. So now the X-ray expert told us there is swelling besides the nose. The fracture is not just the nose bone, it's going to the septum into the skull. And he had broken ribs too, also with swelling, meaning those injuries he received living on lifetime. So this is very new. This we just brought out last Monday. At the same time, the upper court has closed the case. So we can make it short. The legal system is avoiding. This is passive. But not only passive, it's very actively avoiding by destroying evidence, manipulating evidence, putting a lighter there, which has not been there, lying police officers, and manipulating the results of expertises in a way that they interpret doubt into the possibility that he got killed by anybody, and he must have been able to light the fire himself. So this is the stand at the moment. We now have to go to the Constitutional Court to complain that no proper procedures have been done in Germany. If they refuse, we go to the European Court to at least get a result that the European Court says, oh no, this is not possible, actually. You have to do everything to clarify the case, which will be no clarification at the end of the day. This is why we organize for independent networks European-wide. For the problem is not only Uri Jallo, it's not only Idrissa Diallo. There are many cases, and the procedures are always the same. And the families have no chance against the state of law. So the system in itself is wrong. We need something that is even more than this popular prosecution. We need a real independent prosecution that is taking the rights of those cases where harm and deaths occur when the state is involved. So any custody, police, violence, whatever, there must be an independent possibility to charge. For the state prosecution is not doing it.
Ευχαριστούμε. Αν μπορώ να κάνω ένα σχόλιο, είναι ότι ενώ προφανώς οι δύο υποθέσεις είναι αρκετά διαφορετικές, με την έννοια ότι στη μία περίπτωση υπάρχουν ισχυρές υπόνοιες ενεργητικής ουσιαστικά συμμετοχής της αστυνομίας στο έγκλημα, στην άλλη περίπτωση δεν ξέρουμε στην πραγματικότητα τι έχει συμβεί, αλλά υπάρχει ένα κενό το οποίο είναι σημαντικό. Εδώ η κοινή συνισταμένη που αφορά πια και την ελληνική εμπειρία, για την οποία εγώ τουλάχιστον μπορώ να πω δύο πράγματα, είναι ότι πάρα πολύ συχνά έχουμε το φαινόμενο να έχουμε θανάτους στα χέρια του κράτους, στα χέρια της αστυνομίας, θανάτους σε αστυνομικά τμήματα, Ακόμα και αν αυτοί οι θάνατοι δεν αποδοθούν από τα όργανα όπως είναι η ιατροδικαστική υπηρεσία σε μια ενεργητική συμμετοχή της αστυνομίας στο θάνατο, είναι προφανές ότι έχουμε τουλάχιστον μια ισχυρή υποτίμηση των συνθήκων εκείνων που μπορούν να οδηγήσουν στο θάνατο του κρατούμενου από τη μεριά της αστυνομίας. Και αυτή η ισχυρή υποτίμηση πάντα έχει να κάνει με την εθνική καταγωγή, είναι πάρα πολύ συχνά έχει να κάνει με την εθνική καταγωγή του ανθρώπου που βρίσκεται σε κράτηση. Στην ελληνική τουλάχιστον εμπειρία έχουμε ένα πρόσφατο περιστατικό του Εμπουκά Αφρικανού μετανάστη που πέθανε στο τμήμα της Ομόνιας. Η ιατροδικαστική έκθεση το απέδωσε σε παθολογικά αίτια. Αναρωτιόμαστε όμως, άσχετα από αυτό, εάν τυχόν ήταν ένας Έλληνας πολίτης στη δική του θέση, αν τα παράπονα τα οποία θα έκανε και η αδιαθεσία την οποία θα εκδήλωνε θα αντιμετωπιζόταν με διαφορετικό τρόπο από την αστυνομία. Νομίζω σε αυτό το θέμα η απάντηση φοβάμαι είναι προφανής. Επίσης έχουμε μια σειρά από περιπτώσεις μεταχείρισης, κακοποίησης στα χέρια της αστυνομίας που και αυτές είναι σημαντικές και έχουν προκαλέσει θανάτους στα χέρια της αστυνομίας. Πολύ πρόσφατη και πολύ εμβληματική περίπτωση Ζακ Κωστόπουλου, που ένας άνθρωπος ο οποίος είναι σε μια κατάσταση πάρα πολύ δύσκολη και είναι ήδη χτυπημένος, δέχεται κακοποίηση από τη μεριά της αστυνομίας και πεθαίνει στα χέρια της. Εκεί βεβαίως έχουμε να κάνουμε με έναν Έλληνα πολίτη, ένα Έλληνα πολίτη που έχει χαρακτηριστικά τα οποία δεν είναι τα χαρακτηριστικά της λευκής ετεροφιλόφιλης πλειοψηφίας και επομένως η συμπεριφορά της αστυνομίας είναι ιδιαίτερα βάναυση προς το πρόσωπό του ακριβώς εξαιτίας μιας συνείδησης ετερότητας που υπάρχει εκεί πέρα. Η αστυνομία, θυμίζω, ότι υποστήριξε την πρακτική αυτή λέγοντας ότι αυτή είναι η πρακτική μας και σε όποιον αρέσει από επίσημα όργανα της αστυνομίας. Το ίδιο πράγμα είχε υπάρξει με το θάνατο του μετανάστη, μάλλον ομογενούς θα λέγαμε, Σακελίων, αν θυμάστε, μια υπόθεση πάλι στην οποία πάλι εμπλέκεται το αστυνομικό τμήμα Ομόνιας πριν από μια τετραετία, πενταετία, πάλι είναι θάνατος στα χέρια της αστυνομίας σε συνθήκες που φαίνεται ότι υπάρχει τουλάχιστον κακομεταχείριση. Και γενικεύοντας ουσιαστικά και βλέποντας και την ομολογία του Ευρωπαϊκού Δικαστηρίου Ανθρωπίνων Δικαιωμάτων, που οι καταδίκες της Ελλάδας είναι αρκετά συχνές σε σχέση με την απουσία ανεξάρτητης έρευνας για τις συνθήκες θανάτων ή κακομεταχείρισης σε αστυνομικά τμήματα, μπορούμε να δούμε ότι υπάρχει μια τυπολογία. Και η τυπολογία έχει να κάνει πάρα πολύ συχνά, ξαναλέω, με τα χαρακτηριστικά των ανθρώπων οι οποίοι βρίσκονται στα χέρια της αστυνομίας. Είναι μετανάστες, πρόσφυγες, είναι Έλληνες πολίτες, αλλά είναι Ρωμά πάρα πολύ συχνά στις περιπτώσεις αυτές. Είναι η περίπτωση στην οποία η αστυνομία επιδεικνύει απόλυτα διαφορετική συμπεριφορά σε ανθρώπους που δεν ανταποκρίνονται στην τυπολογία του λευκού Έλληνα πολίτη, την οποία σε ένα βαθμό μπορούν να διαχωρίσουν την συμπεριφορά τους και να την κάνουν περισσότερο σύνομη. Στο σημείο αυτό να πούμε ότι και οι θάνατοι στα κέντρα υποδοχής μεταναστών και προσφύγων μπορούν να αναχθούν επίσης σε μια συνθήκη απόλυτης αδιαφορίας για τις συνθήκες υγείας των ανθρώπων που φιλοξενούνται εντός εισαγωγικών στις συνθήκες αυτές, ή ακόμα και έχουμε πάρα πολλά περιστατικά στα οποία η έλλειψη επαρκών συνθήκων διαβίωσης οδηγεί σε φαινόμενα όπως είναι πυρκαγιές εξαιτίας ηλεκτροπληξίας ή εξαιτίας βραχυκυκλωμάτων και τέτοιου τύπου περιστατικών. Όλα αυτά έχουν να κάνουν με μια εγγενή αδιαφορία απέναντι σε ανθρώπους τους οποίους θεωρούμε λιγότερο σημαντικούς, ας πούμε, από τους Έλληνες πολίτες. Και έτσι δεν εξασφαλίζεται το μίνιμουμ στην πραγματικότητα των συνθήκων διαβίωσης. Εδώ λοιπόν υπάρχει μια πάρα πολύ μεγάλη ευθύνη της ελληνικής πολιτείας και σε ένα βαθμό αυτό το πράγμα έχει εξακριβωθεί από διεθνή όργανα όπως είναι το Ευρωπαϊκό Δικαστήριο Ανθρωπίνων Δικαιωμάτων, το οποίο όμως δείχνει και μια απόλυτη έλλειψη εσωτερικού ελεγκτικού μηχανισμού που θα αποδώσει ευθύνες για αυτά τα περιστατικά. Όπως ξέρουμε όσοι τουλάχιστον είμαστε κάτοικοι αυτής της χώρας, υπάρχει μια εσωτερική πειθαρχική διαδικασία η οποία λειτουργεί σε πάρα πολύ μεγάλο βαθμό σε ένας μηχανισμός αθώωσης και ας πούμε απαλλαγής εκ των ευθυνών από τα υπηρεσιακά όργανα, ο εσωτερικός πειθαρχικός μηχανισμός. Ο δε δικαστικός μηχανισμός έχει σε πάρα πολύ μεγάλο βαθμό τα χαρακτηριστικά αυτά του θεσμικού ρατσισμού, ας το πούμε έτσι, δηλαδή εξορισμού, και ο δικαστικός μηχανισμός αντιμετωπίζει τον άλλο, το διαφορετικό, με έναν πάρα πολύ διαφορετικό τρόπο. Και αυτό είναι πάρα πολύ ορατό, ακόμα και σε πολύ λιγότερο σημαντικές υποθέσεις. Μπορεί κανείς να πάει, για παράδειγμα, σε μια δικαστική αίθουσα, σε μια υπόθεση, σε μια δικάσιμο του μονομελούς πλημμυριοδικείου, για να διαπιστώσει ότι οι δικαστές πολύ συχνά αντιμετωπίζουν τους διάδικους, τους κατηγορουμένους, μιλώντας στον πληθυντικό, και όταν έρθει η ώρα του πρόσφυγα, θα είναι ενικός και θα είναι ένας τρόπος συμπεριφοράς που είναι πάρα πολύ διαφορετικός. Ενδεχομένως φαίνεται ασήμαντο, αλλά είναι ενδεικτικό του γεγονότος ότι ο δικαστικός μηχανισμός έχει ενσωματώσει στην πραγματικότητα τη συνθήκη ότι αυτοί οι άνθρωποι είναι διαφορετικοί, έχουν μια άλλη τύπου αντιμετώπιση. Πριν από μία διετία θεσπίστηκε ότι ο συνήγορος του πολίτη είναι ένας μηχανισμός ελέγχου της αστυνομικής αυθαιρεσίας και είναι ένας ανεξάρτητος μηχανισμός έρευνας σε σχέση με περιστατικά αστυνομικής αυθαιρεσίας. Συμπτωματικά την προηγούμενη Παρασκευή έχει βγάλει την πρώτη του έκθεση. Θα έλεγα ότι έχουμε πάρα πολύ δρόμο όμως να διανύσουμε, δηλαδή δεν υπάρχει ένα τέτοιο, θα έλεγα, μια τέτοια τεχνογνωσία και ένα τέτοιο προσωπικό από τη μεριά της ανεξάρτητης αρχής, προκειμένου να πούμε ότι έχουμε πραγματικά αποτελέσματα. Και αυτό είναι κάτι το οποίο από τη δική μας τη μεριά περιμένουμε. Συγγνώμη λίγο για την παρέκβαση, αλλά ήθελα να πω και δύο πράγματα για την ελληνική εμπειρία και θα δώσω αμέσως μετά, δηλαδή τώρα, το βήμα σε εσάς για ερωτήσεις ή ερωτήσεις προς τους καλεσμένους. Παρακαλώ.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Bueno, I will speak in English so everybody can really understand. I mean, there's so many things to say, comment, ask, and give thanks. I would try to be as short as possible so we don't get tired. First of all, I want to express my condolences for all the people that have been affected for this kind of cases. Second, I want to give great thanks and a lot of admiration to Javier and Metromaster and all the people that helped for this film to be done, as well to you guys and all the people that serve this kind of initiatives and works. I think it's like a hope of humanity that we're still people beyond the monster that we have created, from to which we are part of, one way or another. I want to thank as well Roxa Luxemburg for this festival. I think it's very curious and important at the same time that this happens, this screening and this festival happens in Greece, while we have children in Leros, in an island that are being very bad in health. Immigrant children. A lot of people are dying and they're not even detected in Greece. Like Idrissa case, for example, all the other guys' case, like multiplied. I think we've reached the point in humanity that is really shocking. I think at the other hand, these stories as old as Antigone that wanted to bury her brother and couldn't because she was faced in a human law, a natural law, and it's higher than human-made law. This is true. Nevertheless, there are some things that we can always do through cinema, as the cinema of Metromaster, or through initiatives of activism and really empathic initiatives. That is, for example, to really struggle for an independent court, for example, that Thomas Nindaya was proposing before, which I find a brilliant idea. To have like independent bodies that really take care of this kind of situations. I don't think it's a surprise what happens, because of course the system that creates this kind of situations is of course a system that denies to solve problems that he created. I think it's important to focus on the solutions and not get perdernos, like don't get lost within the problem. So yes, I think it's important to remember that we are all immigrants, basically, white people, most of them American people, have went to another continent. Most of us are immigrants because migration is the natural force of human evolution and civilization. And thank you for being here and for your work.
Θα πρότεινα να συνεχίσουμε με το κοινό και στο τέλος οι καλεσμένοι μας να σχολιάσουν όλες τις τοποθετήσεις, εκτός αν είναι κάτι πάρα πολύ συγκεκριμένο που είναι αναρωτηθεί. Επομένως, ο επόμενος ή η επόμενη από το κοινό που θα θέλει να πει κάτι.
I would like to congratulate Javier Artigas for your movie and I would like to ask you if anything has changed concerning the migration centers after the movie.
Μάλλον θα έλεγα να απαντήσετε τώρα, νομίζω, γιατί είναι συγκεκριμένη ερώτηση, ναι.
So sadly, after Idrissa's death, there have been other deaths. So at least we know of three in detention centers, also without in unclear circumstances. So it's very similar cases. And before Idrissa, there were other deaths too. How it has changed since Idrissa? There has been a reform in the detention centers law, which is kind of a makeup because it was supposed to give more guarantee and make it easier for lawyers to get in touch with people that are there. But it has only been makeup because in the practice nothing has changed. There was a very good try from the local government of Barcelona after Ada Colau, our mayor, won the first election, which was to try to close the detention center in Barcelona. Unsuccessful. We had a lot of hope, but it didn't lead anywhere. And nowadays, the detention center of Barcelona is fuller than ever. So there's more and more people. So there is, besides that, there are still cases of alleged torture and diseases and all kinds of problems concerning the detention centers. So the situation has been worse since 2012. There's a new thing, which is kind of a nightmare, which is very recent, which is that they are going to build new detention centers close to the border of Spain, between Spain and Morocco. You know, Spain has two enclaves in Africa. We cannot really say they are colonies because it's a more complex history. It comes from the Middle Ages, but it's a piece of Europe in Africa. It's Ceuta and Melilla. And then there is the sea border of Spain in Andalusia, where a lot of immigrants come. So the plan is to build a new kind of detention centers there, which are going to be for people who are who entered, but legally the authorities don't consider that they are in the national territory. So it's a way of legal formulation that allows police to put these people 72 hours in these new detention centers without seeing a judge, without having any legal procedure, without being able to explain if they are refugees and if they have asylum rights. And they will be able just to have direct pushback back to Morocco. So this is like the newest detention centers are going to be like that, which is completely out of the law because Spanish law and any European treaties do not enter these places. They are outless places in which people come in, but it is as if they were not in the national territory. And there is a case in Spain which was very big scandal. It still is. Which made some, we were trying to find the word in English before, I think it's called jurisprudence, which means that there's like a legal a resolution from a judge that sets an example that can be used for other judges. So, yeah, jurisprudence, which is the case of Tarajal. Tarajal is a beach in Ceuta, which is one of these enclaves, in which people from different African countries, or even people who are refugees from other places, even from Syria, have tried to come into Europe, because once you are in Ceuta, in this enclave, you are in Europe, and you have to, you know, the authorities have to treat you as if, find out what's happens with you. So you have, you. Anyway, what happened in 2000, which year was that, Tarajal? 2014, yeah. 2014, a group of about 100 people tried to reach the beach by swimming in the early in the morning, and the Spanish police decided it was a good idea to dissuade them from entering by shooting them rubber bullets. So a lot of these people were touched by these rubber bullets, and 15 of the, at least 15 of them died while trying to swim. And the Spanish police and the Spanish state never recognized responsibility for that. They always said it was their own fault because they drowned, because they didn't know how to swim. So it took us a long time to prove that they actually shot rubber bullets. And it was proof, because there are videos and there's detonation sounds. And at the end, they had to recognize that they used rubber bullets. But then they said, okay, you're right, we use rubber bullets, but we use them to show the illegal immigrants where is the line that separates Spain from Africa. So to show them the European border. So this is the reason why. I mean, it sounds like a joke, but they really did that. And they nothing happened. So the case has been dismissed 3 times. Last time it was dismissed, it was yesterday. So it's a very recent thing. And as I said, there's a strong jurisprudence in this case, because the people who did arrive to the beach, the ones that did not die, although they were fighting for their lives and they almost drowned, they came into the Spanish beach. And what the Spanish police did is to open the fence that separates Morocco from Spain and push them back to Morocco, which is completely illegal. It's an illegal pushback operation. But the judge decided, and this is very new, that the actual border between Spain and Africa, between Europe and Africa, is not the geographical border that you can see in a map, but the policemen who are in custody of the border are the ones setting the border. So we call it an elastical border. So if the policemen are back, although they are in the national territory, they can push the immigrants back to Africa, and they haven't entered Spanish territory, which doesn't make any sense at all. But this has a legal status, and now they are using that in order to build these new detention centers, in which they can say, okay, they are in our national territory, but we cannot really consider that they entered Europe, so we can push them back immediately.
Και εδώ μπορούμε να σκεφτούμε και ομοιότητες πάλι με τη δική μας περίπτωση και την πολύ πρόσφατη συζήτηση που γίνεται σε σχέση με τα θέματα των αποθήσεων δια της θάλασσας. Ελπίζουμε να μην μπουν ιδέες και στους δικούς μας, έτσι, και προκληθεί έτσι η δημιουργία νομολογίας αντίστοιχης με την ισπανική, αλλά δεν είμαστε δυστυχώς μακριά από την πρακτική αυτή, όπως ξέρουμε όλοι. Νομίζω ότι έχουμε άλλα 5 περίπου λεπτά, αν το καταλαβαίνω σωστά, ή 10. Επομένως, αν υπάρχει μια τελευταία ή δύο χέρια βλέπω, δύο τελευταίες έτσι ερωτήσεις ή τοποθετήσεις, 3. Παρακαλώ έτσι λίγο σύντομα απλώς, να αυτοπεριοριστούμε. Νομίζω έχετε ζητήσει και εσείς στο βάθος, ναι.
Thank you very much. Yeah, Javier was kind of hinting at this, but there's a way in which both of the cases that you are all working on are related to a lack of acknowledgement of responsibility, and that seems to be really a key element. And I find it very ironic that when refugee solidarity activists are trying to look at the world in a new way, in a more borderless way. European countries are responding in a way that also does change the borders, but sort of pushes the borders beyond the European states in order to put responsibility outside of their borders, like you were talking about, Javier, with the detention centers that are not technically in Europe. Since all of your projects are related to finding or getting an admission of responsibility and perhaps even an apology from the states in question, I wonder what could that kind of acknowledgement of responsibility lead to, and where could we go from there if that's a first step?
Υπάρχει κάποιος άλλος που θέλει να ρωτήσει ή έχουμε καλυφθεί και να δώσουμε το λόγο στους καλεσμένους να απαντήσουν? Νομίζω το δεύτερο, έτσι. Επομένως, να δώσω πρώτα το λόγο μάλλον στην Αντίν να τοποθετηθεί ενδεχομένως στην τελευταία ερώτηση που υπήρξε και τον Τόμας.
I want to mention two things. One thing is that we know that the police is doing it, and we know that the crimes that the police do are covered up by the courts and also like experts, medical experts, forensic experts, whatever. But what we experience in the case of Uri Jallo and also in all the other cases, because it's not a single case, it's a structure behind, and the structure can just exist because the society of the European country is keeping quiet about it. And this is really one of the most worst thing. They can just act because the society, the white society, is not screaming, it's not scandalizing, it's just accepting it, ignoring it, you know, and it just, yeah, that's the way it can happen, because the people keep quiet about it. And we started a campaign in 2005, which is called Breaking the Silence. And this is actually, you know, we can blame the police, but actually we have to blame ourselves because nobody is really doing something. It's just a handful of activists who are doing, and it took us a very, very long time to, you know, they put a lot of repression to the activists and to the friends of Uri, and also, of course, to the family of Uri Jallo. But for all the people in Dessau, the friends of Uri, they just deported them. They try to get rid of them. They try to criminalize all the resistance, all the struggle to clarify the case. And it took us so much energy and so much time to prove all the things that we found out. And then slowly, slowly, we got more and more and more support. And now we are, you know, all this is what we are doing. We build up our international investigation team. It's like an independent group of lawyers and experts and so on and so on. And it costs us a lot of money. All the last years, we spent like 150,000 euros in all the expertises we do. I mean, we can just do that because a lot of people support us now, but the main society is not understanding, is not willing to understand what is necessary to be human. You know, it's really unhuman what they are doing, and it's unhuman that they expect, as that they ignore it and they just act the way they are not acting. At all.
Thomas, do you want to add something?
Expectation, you ask. To this state, as it is, as it actually has been for 500 years and longer, as a continuity, we don't expect anything. I've never seen any white apology that was really meant. So even reparations are not done. So from that point, our expectations are not addressed to the state. If we talk of racism, we have to understand it's systemic. So it starts with the people drowning in the sea. with the people enslaved in Libya, with the borders controlled by the EU in Africa, with the exploitation of the African countries, and with the stealing of the resources of the people there. And we also have to understand that the problem as it is now is not due to the people, it's due to the border management. So if the borders would be open, we wouldn't have this all these dead people and all these problems. Think of the European Union expansion to the east. We have had the same discussions. Oh, these Polish people will come, take our women, our work, everything. Then everywhere will be Poles and Romanians, Bulgarians. We don't have space for ourselves, blah, 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 blah. So what happened? What is the situation now? Where are all these Polish people? Where are all these Bulgarian people? If they are free to move, they move to and fro. Like you white people are allowed to move all over the planet. So allow it to anybody else, and we don't have this sort of problem in the first place. Secondly, if we talk of the state of law, we have a lot of laws, international, national laws. But if it's about officers of state, then you don't see that laws. A police officer is killing you and in impunity. This is part of his job. If you take away the possibility for the police officers to be violent and murderous, you won't find people to do it. You know? So what is the point of running around in a uniform and tell people what to do? There's no sense behind it, really. You know? So if people don't fear you as an officer, then you don't have any power. So the system of police will sort of break down. The social police is not part of the structure police. You know, like a friendly police guiding you over the street, helping you here, putting you there, you know. No, it's not meant like that. You have to be sure about that. So, and at least the expectation is that we, as a civil society, have to compensate. We know now the state is not doing it, willingly not doing it. So somebody else has to do it. And it's not only when it's too late, when it happened. It has to start earlier. We have to watch the police. We have to go to the police. We have to tell the police, you are my officer. I'm not your citizen. You are my officer. So please, you know, do accordingly. If we have a critical mass in those situations, this will be the first step of change. Then we have education to our children, not to tell them how beautiful and nice and successful white people have been. No, they have been killers, murderers, whatever, since their existence, since they talk of history, since they wrote it down. You know, the colonial times, world wars, and even nowadays, it's like that. And it's not only black people, it's not only migrant people, it's psychological impaired people, it's homophobia is there, so chauvinism is there, only the power to do so. So even you white people are victim at the time. There are also white people killed by the police. So we have to stand together and we have to build this force independently from state. For as soon as the state is involved, we will get nowhere.
Μία τελευταία σκέψη από τον Χαβιέρ, τον οποίο οφείλουμε και την σημερινή βραδιά σε μεγάλο βαθμό, ως μέλος της συλλογικότητας που κάνει αυτή την πάρα πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα ταινία.
So, yeah, as an activist, I totally agree with what Tom and Nadine said. I mean, I don't think I can add up anything. Maybe I can add something as a filmmaker. And I think in such cases, it is our duty to sometimes, and answering your question, to turn back the camera towards ourselves, and this connects very well with the idea that Tom said about our responsibility as a society. So racism is institutional, but it's also structural. And I think as filmmakers, we have a strong responsibility not to show stories in which there are good guys and bad guys, and to point them out, and to let the audience feel well when they know who are the bad guys, because, you know, we can detect them and then we are the good ones, but to make them feel uncomfortable because we are all responsible of these cases. And in this sense, in our film, there is a very first scene, which is very important, in which there is a guy in a hotel next to a comfortable swimming pool, having a sunbath, and there is a fence, and on the other side of the fence there are like black children, African children playing football. And we put ourselves in the side of the fence where the white person is. I think this is pretty obvious. And it's a way of saying, be careful. We're going to tell you a story, but it's from this side of the fence. It's from the perspective of the people who are responsible of all this shit. I think activism needs to communicate, needs to do strategical litigation and explain how the system works. But as filmmakers, I think sometimes we have to get away from common places and look at things differently. And I think this is the way we can realize how, in this case, this structural racism works, and maybe make us feel bad when we have to be part of this funeral scene of Idrissa, which doesn't have any anthropological interest. It's a way of making you be part of that, because this is the shit that we built. So just face it and stay there until the end. So yeah, I think this is the role that we can we need to take as artists or filmmakers. And thank you.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ που μείνατε μέχρι αυτή την ώρα. Και νομίζω όμως ότι αποζημιωθήκατε και από την ταινία και από την κουβέντα. Ευχαριστούμε.